Greetings, and welcome to the first lecture in a course brought to you by math-based tutoring, PreAlgebra. This course goes back to the beginning of mathematics, and it's designed for people who are pretty much going back to college or just really want to start from the beginning when they learn math. We're going to start with numbers and basic arithmetic and move up and through basic algebra in this course. It is brought to you for free by Math-Based Tutoring. We're on Facebook at facebook.com/math-based-tutoring. We offer distance learning tutoring with free software that is easy to use at a very affordable price. We also tutor all levels of high school and calculus, differential equations, and linear algebra, and other college algebra courses as well. This course is a little bit different is because it's written with an open source textbook. This means that the textbook is free for anyone to use and read online. It's sponsored by Rice University. So if you have downloaded the textbook on PDF, this lecture will start on page 15, and you can follow along with the lecture and read along as I lecture the course. I'm not going to read the textbook to you, but the lectures are pretty close to the textbook. If you have a printed copy of the textbook that you have purchased, we'll be on page 7. And the people, I'd like to thank the authors, and they are listed on the screen for writing this textbook. Let's get started. One of the biggest problems that people have with mathematics is translation. And what I mean by translation is that mathematics is a completely different foreign language. Instead of words, it uses symbols and numbers. Symbols are verbs, adjectives, and nouns. For example, equal sign's a verb. A lot of people may or may not realize that. Mathematics has its own vocabulary. And there are certain sentences in mathematics that are just written with symbols. If you don't understand what the symbol is or what the symbol represents, then you really will struggle with that particular topic. Mathematics uses numbers and symbols to express words and ideas. A good example of this is even if you had a children's book written in Polish and you didn't speak Polish. Let's just say it was maybe Dr. Seuss's Cat in the Hat. Could you pick up a copy of that book written in Polish or Chinese or Korean or a language that you didn't speak and understand it even though it was Dr. Seuss's Cat in the Hat? The same thing goes with a calculus book. If you picked up a calculus book and you had never done mathematics in your life, you might have some struggle understanding the symbols involved in calculus. So mathematics uses numbers, and that's what we're going to start with, are two different types of numbers. We call them sets, groups of numbers. And the first of these is the counting numbers, and it's the numbers that we use to count things. The counting numbers, often also referred to by some mathematicians as natural numbers, start at the number 1 and continue forever. So here's a formal definition of the counting numbers. They start at 1 and continue infinitely, or forever. So if I was to write these down, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I could continue forever for the rest of my life and still not write all of the counting numbers. So what mathematicians do is use a symbol called an ellipsis. So what this symbol is, these three dots, is it represents that the pattern continues forever. So in other words, instead of writing 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and so on, we just put three dots. This is called an ellipsis. And a reminder that the counting numbers are also called natural numbers. One thing about numbers is they can all be graphed visually. In fact, back in early mathematics, there was a lot of what we call plain geometry. And they weren't even writing down the numbers to do computations. They were using compasses and a number line, for example, to do multiplication, addition, subtraction. Later, they were bisecting line segments or trisecting, you know, dividing it into three places. But the main point I'm trying to get across is here is that all numbers can be visualized on a number line. And here's the counting numbers on a number line. So notice that this line here has an arrow on one side and it doesn't have an arrow on this side. That means that the numbers are increasing in the way that the arrow goes. And the arrow also indicates that the number increases forever. Now they also decrease forever in the same, we're not going to talk about those numbers yet, but just because there isn't an arrow over here doesn't mean that they don't decrease. It just means that this is the way that the numbers increase. The origin is what we call any point that is labeled zero. So the origin is right here. You can label numbers on a number line in any way you want, as long as these coordinates, which is what we call these points here, and we'll get to that in a minute, are equally spaced. And we're going to learn that there's an infinite amount of numbers between the number 5 and 6. There's more than, you know, there's 5 and a half, 5 and a third, 5 and a quarter. But this is a way to visualize numbers. And again, a number that is paired with a point is referred to as a coordinate. So this is the coordinate 4. This is the coordinate 3. Later in the course, we'll see that we can have another line going this way to represent two-dimensional coordinates. One of the things in mathematics is that zero was actually discovered, and I use that word loosely because zero has been around forever. Somebody just actually had to discover and use it. It was discovered after all the other numbers were used. More people, debt, which would be negative numbers, like if you owed somebody something, you'd have -$5. If you owed somebody $5, those negative numbers were actually discovered before zero. In fact, we could go back to the Babylonians, and I won't go too far into their complex number system, but they had a different number system than the one we use, which is the decimal system. They even started writing their numbers without using zero. And it was difficult because the number 2, 20, and 200 all look the same because they didn't have a symbol for zero. So then, after discovering zero, we had a new set of numbers, which we call the whole numbers. And the whole numbers are the numbers that we're going to use mostly in the first several lectures of this course. We're going to be dealing with the whole numbers. And the whole numbers are just the counting numbers and zero. So what do those look like? Well, here we have the counting numbers, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and an ellipsis to indicate that they continue forever, and zero. Okay, let's look at an example. And if you're following along in the book, you might notice that after each example, there's a you try it problem. I recommend that you attempt these, and then in the description below, there's a link to another video with a solution to these you try it problems for each video that we're going to do. Okay, so the first example says, which of the following numbers are A, counting numbers, and B, whole numbers? Okay, so let's look at these each individually. Let's find the counting numbers first. So zero is not a counting number. We never mentioned anything about fractions, so we know that 1/4 is not a counting number. 3 is the third counting number, 1, 2, 3, so that's going to be in our list. We never mentioned anything about decimals, and decimals are not counting numbers, so 5.2 or 5 2/10 will not be in either of these lists. If we continue counting after 5, we'll eventually get 15. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So 15 is a counting number. And if we keep counting longer, eventually we'll get to 105. So the counting numbers in this list were 3, 15, and 105. Now we know that the whole numbers are the counting numbers, so it's going to be 3, 15, and 105, and 0, since 0 is in the list. So the whole numbers are 0, 3, 15, and 105. So that's going to conclude the first lecture in our course PreAlgebra. I'd like to keep these videos between 10 and 15 minutes long, nice and short and sweet, so you learn a topic and then make sure you ingest it all before we start the next portion. So the sections in the book are split up into smaller lectures so that they're short and you don't have to sit through 50 minutes of me going like this. You can get along, you know, get 10 minutes and boom. If you have any questions, you can comment below. If you like the video, please click that like button. Again, if you have a tutoring need, you can contact us on facebook.com/mathspacetutoring, and you can always ask questions about the lectures. Just make sure that you specify which lecture you are questioning, and I will return your question as soon as I can. I appreciate you watching, and we'll see you in the next video.